judge us according to our performances. The capacity to receive comes with so much grace, because you know for sure that God shall supply all my needs according to His riches in glory. He shall supply. You speak upon it. You are identified by the blood of Jesus. The blood that was shed at the cross. In Him we have redemption through His blood. The forgiveness of our trespasses according to the riches of His grace. He became that sin offering. So what? Are you still talking about sin, sin, sin? That is a wrong doctrine. By one offering, He has perfected forever those who are being sanctified. He has affected you. You have no sin. Once Christ is the central focus of who you are and your life, your identity changes, your mindsets change, your thinking, your living, because now you're believing right, you're living right through Him.
Wake up and unwind your day.
醒来, 开始你的一天.
Réveillez-vous et commencez votre journée avec
Bioka, utkikurumusiwawe.
On a heart for a soul.
Your word is truth. Sanctifies a soul with your truth. Your word is true.
For a soul, a heart for a soul. The light and warm your spirit in the dark or the cold. Healing what was broken, turn them parts to a whole. Heart for a soul, a heart for a soul.
Yeah, Jesus Christ, way, truth, and the life. For our souls paid the price, the ultimate sacrifice. What a love, while we yet sin, for death we were destined. He stepped in as water and His blood was the cleansing. Lost, we were found, where sin abounds, grace abounds. What a passion, a peace of passing on understanding, where God's love is present, all condemnation is passed in.
For a soul, a heart for a soul. The light and warm your spirit in the dark or the cold. Healing what was broken, turn them parts to a whole. Heart for a soul, a heart for a soul.
Father, we thank You so much for the words that You've yet given us. We thank You for today. As we come, we want to honor You for every single thing You've done in our lives, whether big, whether small, whether unknown, whether known, any single thing. Because we thank You that with You, everything turns to work out for good. Papa, we thank You for each and every blessing that we've counted, that we've not even yet counted, that we know of, that we've not yet actually also seen in the physical. Because we believe that the cross, You paid it all for us. When You said it is finished, You meant it was finished. And so today, we're taking that place, receiving our inheritance, receiving the blessing of the Lord, receiving the rest in Jesus, receiving the glory, and beholding the glory of Jesus Christ, full of grace and truth. In Jesus' name we pray and say, Amen. Saints, I want to welcome you again on today's program. For those who are joining us for the very, very first time, we also want to acknowledge you. We want to say, thank the Lord that You found us. And may God answer your prayers, answer your questions. If you're searching for truth, you're searching for answers in life, I just pray that the Lord Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, will be your answer. Because He has been an answer to all of us. For me, He has been an answer. And when I preach about Jesus, I preach about the one that I've seen, the one I've heard, the one that I know that He is able, and the one that I know He's a King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Amen? So with that being said, I want us to go into the Word. Today, I'm really going to preach about something that has really been in my spirit for quite some time. And I truly believe this is food from the Lord Jesus. I truly believe that the Holy Spirit has placed it on my heart that to preach this message at this given time. I want us to open our Bibles in 1 Timothy chapter 3, and I'll be reading from in verse 9. Amen. Our entire sermon is going to be based on just that one scripture. I truly believe that the Lord is going to speak in each and everyone's life listening in today. Amen. That's not just an encouragement. That is a word of prophecy, because I truly believe in the spirit right now where we are, that we as children of God, we need to know who we are. We need to know What are we believing? What are we listening to? What are we partaking? What is salvation actually? What is all this? Because sometimes we think actually we know something. There's a difference between knowing something and actually believing something. Knowing something, I can preach, right? I can preach to you and, you know, you hear the sermon and you know, oh, this is what she means. But then there's also a different step or the next step of you actually believing what I spoke or what you've been preached to. Two different things, but they all carry a weight in each of itself. 1 Timothy 3:9 says, holding the mystery of the faith with a pure conscience. It says, holding the mystery of the faith with a pure conscience. Amen? Like I've said, salvation is a gift of grace. And Lord, we thank you so much for this great gift. We thank you as we partake today. We thank you for salvation. We thank you for each and every word that you feed us in this place. We thank you for this gift of salvation. You know, like I said, salvation is a gift of grace. It is one of the greatest gifts that any person, and this I speak plainly, any person can receive, and their life is transformed forever. A lot of times some people could say, evangelist, I don't really think that's the only, salvation is the only thing that can literally change your life. Someone can give me a gift of, let's say, someone could say wealth, of an inheritance that can change the rest of my life. Yeah, at some point, you know, that can also be true. But what salvation offers, money can't give. What salvation offers, man can never give. What salvation can offer you as a child of God or any person around the world or any person listening in today, nothing on the face of the earth, nothing can ever equate or can ever come onto the same level as what the gift of grace of salvation can ever offer you. And that is why, for any person who has received salvation and acquired it by revelation, and they know what they're carrying within themselves, they've learned not to take it for granted. They've learned not to play around with it. You know, just like Esau played around with his birthright. And this is something also we can't take for granted. There's a time where you reach and you grow by the grace of God. You grow in the knowledge of the Lord. You grow in the wisdom of God. And you find yourself can't even accept money to do something just because you wanna honor that gift upon you. You know, there's that time that any believer can get to. And you know for sure that salvation is a gift of grace and it is holy. I must behold it in reverence. Amen? So for any believer to receive salvation, for any person to receive salvation, they must first of all have confessed, believed in faith that Jesus Christ is the Lord and Savior of their life. Amen? Like I said, salvation is really different from any other gift any person can ever experience. Because with salvation comes freely to us. It's not something we work for. It's not something we deserve. It's not something that actually any of us qualified for. It is something that was given to us as a result of God loving us so much and wanting to reconcile with us. Amen? Because we were sinners. We were born in sin. We were born in a place where as human beings, we were unrighteous. But God loved us so much that he decided and he knew that my son would be the one to take up their place and become a lamb that would be slain. He became the sin offering. He became the trespass offering. And I think actually I told about that a few weeks ago. If you can find those sermons, you come to know more about Jesus Christ being your sin offering at the cross and also being your trespass offering. Hallelujah. So there is something beyond what human beings can understand or perceive of being born again. You know, being born again or being saved, let's say whatever we want to call it in this context, it is not something actually you can comprehend with your own mind. It is not something you can sit down and say, now today I'm going to be born again. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do this. And God is going to do this for me. That is not how it works. Salvation, it comes with grace. It comes as a gift. And once you receive it, you know it. You know it by spirit. You know it in faith that this is of God. This has been given to me, not by man, not by anything, but you know, and you believe, and you trust, and you stand in faith knowing that you're different. Amen? So the question is, what really happens after receiving salvation through grace by faith? What happens after you believe? Then what happens next? Because a lot of times, many people ask that question, right? And sometimes certain people, just because they don't get the answer or the response to that, some of them can actually shun away salvation. They say, no, this is not for me, or this is not my time. Certain times people use that excuse. Certain times people say, until when I understand this, that is when I'm going to give my life to Jesus Christ. But like I said, salvation is not a concept. It is not a theory. It is not a mechanism. It is not something that any scholar can talk to you about and then you now say, I've got it. Now I'm going to get born again. No! It is supernatural. It is divine. It is a gift that is so divine that you're led by Christ. You're led of the Spirit of the Lord to reveal to you the true love of God and His rich mercies. And this is something actually that is very important that many of us must, you know, by the grace of God, if we go back to the time that you received that very, very spot that you received, confessed and believed the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. There's that time when you reached and you just felt like it wasn't you. You felt like it was just a part of you that was broken, that had surrendered, that had submitted fully and for all to Christ Jesus. And this is some things that not even any person, not even any scientific theory or fact or anything or a study can bring into existence or bring into interpretation. You can't. So the very most common question that always lingers around many either new believers or people who want to know about being born again is that very question. What really happens after I receive salvation? What is next now that I have confessed and believed the Lord Jesus Christ is my Lord and Savior? That is why usually at the end of this service every week, if you come to a realization for those who have been listening in, that I always say and I always remind and always encourage those who have received salvation on this program that you find a local church and be planted so that you receive more growth in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. Salvation does not stop by you just confessing and believing the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Salvation is, it becomes your life. It becomes your culture. It becomes your lifestyle. It becomes a part of who you are. It becomes your identity. It becomes a part of who you are, a part that defines you, a part that is comprised of you. So if any person, anything is to talk about you, it becomes that. That becomes part of who you are. Amen? It creates the life, the norms, the values, the beliefs, the views in your life, the insightful information in you. You are now, once you confess and believe, the very next step, the Holy Spirit takes over. The Holy Spirit starts to lead you, to guide you, to take you deeper in the word, to make you understand who this Jesus is that you've received. You know, after we believe, like I said, many people ask what really happened. What really happens is that, number one, your consciousness in Jesus Christ is bridged. The Holy Spirit helps your consciousness that you as a person you had before you came to Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, but he enables your consciousness, or he helps bridge that gap between the old man by transforming you into a new man. And then also, he does not stop there. He gets that new believer, that new child in Christ, and he gives you that initial identification where he transforms you into the newness of life in Christ Jesus. That is why, child of God, at some point when we became born again, right? The things that we did in our previous life, we came to a place where we said, this is not who I am. This is not part of who I am. So that means at that moment, by the grace of God, it can be gradually, it can be a process, it can be instantaneously done. We are all different. Our calling is all different. Our relationship with Jesus Christ is all different. But the consciousness, child of God, for each and every believer, whether it took a process, whether it took a gradual way or manner, or, you know, in any way, you as a child of God grew in the Lord Jesus Christ, your consciousness, every single person's consciousness, was transformed into the consciousness of Christ Jesus. Amen. So our consciousness, through the help of the Holy Spirit, was bridged from the old man to the new man in Christ Jesus. And that consciousness enhanced that transformation into the newness of life in Christ Jesus. And so as I speak actually right now, by the grace of God, when we walk in the newness of life in Christ Jesus Christ, that is the same journey we're walking into eternal life. So right now, any believer listening in today, you're walking a journey that is eternal, a journey that is new in Christ Jesus, a journey that is led of the Spirit of the Lord, a journey that is Spirit-guided, a journey that is not the same as the journey you had before. That is why it brings me back to that place where people ask themselves, what really happens after I receive salvation? And once some of these things are really not articulated by the revelation of the Lord, many people get stranded. They get lost. Tend to say, okay, yes, I am a believer. I am born again. I am saved. But they still run to their past. They're still running into their old patterns. They're still running into their self-righteousness, self-consciousness, self-effort, self-determination, that whole thing. You find that you're pulling strings of your old life and your new life. But there's a difference. And that is what the Holy Spirit does, because it's the guarantee of the promise of the inheritance that we've received from God. So child of God, by the grace of God, what happens next is that the consciousness that is within you, child of God, amen? Your views, your beliefs, your insights, your perceptions, your imagination is all captured by the Holy Spirit. Amen? So as a new believer's consciousness in Jesus Christ, the Holy Spirit also helps you bridge that gap between your faith. Amen? So this is actually also very, very important. I know I've talked about the consciousness, but then also the faith. The faith that as you as a child of God, that burgeons in you, that is rooted and established in Jesus Christ, and you know for sure, and you know that this is the will of the Lord, and I'm going to walk this journey. Many people, when they come to salvation, not all people find it so easy to get out there and say, I'm born again. For some, it is easy because You may have been born in a Christian home, or you maybe have you may have been born in a community where they can easily embrace, you know, Christianity, right? And for sure, and when you wake up in the morning, you say, you know what, I've given my life to the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm now born again. And so people will be happy for you, but it will be okay. But the, on the other hand, the people whose lives either are at stake if they take this decision, you know, if they've been living in a community where Christianity is not something people believe in, or whether they've been in a family where the Christianity or salvation is not seen as something that is true, right? For those people, once they become born again, once they confess the Lord Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior, what happens next is that the Holy Spirit bridges their consciousness, anything of fear, anything in them that can, you know, bring them back to that place whereby they cannot stand and say, I am born again and I'm going to embrace this and I'm going to speak no matter whoever comes my way. I'm just going to stand and say, I am for Christ and Christ is for me. And from today, I am born again. Now, the Holy Spirit will stand with every believer to acquire that faith, to be submitted to the will of God, and come to that place in life where they walk in salvation without any fear, without having no any doubt in them or saying that anything, I'm so scared of this person, I'm so scared of this issue, I'm so scared of the community, I'm so scared of the society, and people stand. Amen. So these are very two significant points that any of you listening in today, if any of you by the grace of God received salvation, some of you have either experienced what I've explained, or some of you are yet to experience it, or some of us, there could be also another category who went through that life or process, but you never actually came to a realization that this actually happens. Consciousness, every human being has consciousness. Even when we were in the old life, we had consciousness. We had the consciousness of the flesh. We had the consciousness of the world. We had the consciousness of sin. We had the consciousness, just as the children of Israel, as it is written in the scriptures, you see that because of the law, at all times they had the consciousness of sin. At some point, you know, they had to offer a sin offering. They had to offer a trespass offering, the burnt offering. There were so many offerings that they had to offer for them to be redeemed from sin. So, child of God, every person has come in that place where they had that state of mind, that consciousness, where their feelings, their emotions, anything that pertains to life was best in the worldly way. But when we become born again, the next step that happens to us, the Holy Spirit takes over and the Holy Spirit works upon our consciousness. So, and then we become, because of faith, right? We are saved by grace. Amen? We are saved through grace. By faith, we walk in salvation for the rest of our lives by the grace of God. Amen? So, us walking in faith, it leads us to the will of God. Hallelujah. Faith enables us to actually walk the walk of salvation, but also walk in the will of the Lord, walking in the will that God predestined us or predetermined for us to be when we would become born again. Hallelujah. So the question sometimes actually people ask is, what is the will of God? Evangelist, what is the will of God for me? So, the will of God, child of God, before the beginning of time till eternity, was the will of God is for everyone to believe in the Son of the living God. Not many people would believe this. Not many people can say that is true, because the scriptures show us that when Jesus Christ came on earth, right? He was to redeem every single person for those who would believe. You know, when we go back in the scriptures, you see that Israel, right, denied him. The Jews denied him. They didn't receive the grace covenant. They didn't receive him as God had sent him on earth to redeem them. The Gentiles believed. Amen? The Gentiles came to believe the Lord Jesus Christ, and some Jews did actually. For instance, Apostle Paul, he was Saul before. He persecuted all Christians. He persecuted those who believed in Jesus Christ. But at some point later, him actually came to believe the Lord Jesus Christ as his Lord and Savior. And he preached the gospel that Jesus Christ began to preach. So not all of them denied him, but some Jews turned. Some Jews came to see the revelation of God through Jesus Christ. So, taking me back to what I was saying, what is the will of God? The will of God is for everyone to believe in his son, Jesus Christ. Let's open our Bibles in John 5 to show you what I mean. John 5 opens us up to something very, very important for us to receive. John 5:19 says, I'm going to read from 19 to 25. It says, "Then Jesus answered and said to them, most assuredly, I say to you, the Son can do nothing of himself, but what he sees the Father do, for whatever he does, the Son also does in like manner. For the Father loves the Son and shows him all things that he himself does, and he will show him greater works than these, that you may marvel. For as the Father raises the dead and gives life to them, even so the Son gives life to whom he will. For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgment to the Son, that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. Most assuredly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes in him who sent me has everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life." So, child of God, Jesus did not come to change us from being bad to good. Jesus Christ came to redeem those who are dead, which we were, child of God. Every sinner, every unrighteous man and woman, we were dead. We were dead. But he brought us to life to become alive in God by the grace of God through salvation. Colossians 2:13 says that. So, in other words, child of God, from what the scriptures we've seen, if I go back to that question, that the rhetorical question that I ask, what is the will of God? This passage unveils to us the depth of the will of God. The will of God is for the Father to raise the dead and give life to them, which we were in the old life, which every single person listening in today, which I also were, every single believer were, child of God. The will of God is that God the Father raises the dead and gives life to them. Even so, the Son gives life to whom he will. Jesus Christ gave us life. He gave us life. So the will of God is for us to believe on his Son, Jesus Christ. Or also to believe in him as his Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. John 6:29 says that Jesus answered and said unto them, "This is the work of God, that you believe in him who he sent." Salvation is all embedded and based and rooted and founded and established in Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. The will of God is for us, child of God, every single dear listener today, is for us to honor his Son, Jesus Christ. Going back to the scripture, he said, Jesus Christ said that, "For the Father judges no one, but has committed all judgments to the Son." That means that God gave him the authority in heaven and on earth. That means that all things consist in Jesus. That means that, child of God, the consciousness that we had previously, and as we were transformed in the newness of life in Christ Jesus through the Holy Spirit, the entire judgment in us was embedded and changed in Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. And the scripture further says in John 5:23, that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. So meaning that, child of God, as we honor God the Father, we honor his Son, Jesus Christ. Because when we see Jesus Christ, child of God, anytime you see Jesus Christ in the Word, anytime you hear of Jesus Christ, you're hearing God the Father. Because God the Father is Jesus Christ. He came in flesh and dwelt among us. And we behold him because he is full of grace and truth. Amen. So one's consciousness, child of God, will be determined by what you believe. As long as you believe in Jesus Christ, your consciousness will be transformed into Christ. Your consciousness will be directed to Jesus Christ. Your consciousness will now not be of the world. Your consciousness will not be of your sins. Your consciousness will not be of your lack. Your consciousness will not be of sickness. Your consciousness will not be of unrighteousness. Your consciousness will be in Christ Jesus. Because what you believe is what you become. Child of God, right believing is right living. Amen? Right thinking is right living. When you're thinking of Jesus, when your thoughts, your entire insightfulness, your entire interpretation, your entire living and being is only in Jesus Christ, child of God, your life will be transformed from within and out, and you become Jesus. Amen? So where your heart is, child of God, it will determine where your treasure is. And many times you find that we even believers, right? Once you start to let the world define who you are, you also accept the views of the world and their philosophies and insightful information to lead how you should think, how to shape your life. Then that means that your consciousness is just going to be limited to how the world sees things. Amen? That is why the Bible says in Proverbs 4 that guard your heart. Because where your heart is where your treasure is. Where your heart's desires are they in Christ? Are they in things of Jesus? Are they deep in his presence, in his love, in his reverence, in his word? Where your heart is where your treasure is. So consciousness is us being aware of our inner and external existence in Jesus Christ today. As believers, our Christ consciousness, whether inside us, whether in the outer part of us, our existence must be in Christ Jesus. He said in the word, going back, he says that all should honor the Son just as they honor the Father. He who does not honor the Son does not honor the Father who sent him. And he says that most assuredly, I say to you that he who hears my word and believes of him, he who sent me has it everlasting life and shall not come into judgment, but has passed from death into life. So child of God, our consciousness is in life. And who is life? Life is Jesus. When Lazarus died and he appeared to come and meet the sisters, Martha and Mary, and Martha was telling him, the teacher, if you had been here, my brother would not have died, right? And Jesus Christ told her, I am the life and the resurrection. So if you, child of God, listening in today, child of God, dear believer, beloved, if you need life in your every aspect of your life, if you need anything to be brought to life, Jesus Christ is the answer. Amen? Because death is a sign of the world. Anything that can diminish, anything that can vanish, anything that cannot stay, you know, eternity or for eternal life, that thing is of the world. But you, child of God, you carry divine life in you. You carry Jesus in you. And that is why one's perception or awareness must be based on Christ, but not based otherwise on self or any surroundings or people or the worldly nature. Amen? So when we are born again believers, our consciousness becomes transformed and it is focused, it is concentrated on Jesus Christ through the help of the Holy Spirit. And let me say something that is actually very imperative. This is not something we force. It is something that comes by, like I said, salvation is a gift of grace. So the Holy Spirit outpours. He continuously teaches you. He continuously guides you. He continuously increases you in the knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. So one thing we must know, that as we believe, that our belief must be in the positive expectation of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we must rest and hope in the finished works of Jesus Christ. Amen. 2 Corinthians 4:10 says that always carry about in your body the dying of the Lord Jesus, that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our body. So meaning that consciousness is so, the consciousness in Jesus Christ is so powerful that once you're child of God, you're carrying it within you, right? You become part of who he is. And as once you become as part of who he is, you manifest Jesus Christ in your body. That means that you're not going to be the people think you are. You're not. When you enter a certain place, everything bows down because Jesus has entered. What you're carrying in you, child of God, is Jesus. What you're representing out there is Jesus. What you're thinking is Jesus. What you're speaking is Jesus. What you see is of Jesus. So, can I ask a rhetorical question? What happens in between the years of faith? Many times, you know, like I said when we were beginning the service, right? When we come into salvation, many people have that question, okay, what is next? And once the next is gotten, many times people ask themselves between the years, right? The start of kind of that fire they started with, it sort of like diminishes. Like, you know how a curve, many of you have drawn some of those curves in economics or kind of study of physics or something. And there's that place where it can go higher. And there's that time when the curve comes back down, you know? There's that depreciation of anything. But once you see that that is the life of or the walk you're having in salvation, it's by the grace of God that we must come back onto our knees and speak to the Holy Spirit, speak to the Lord and say, Daddy, I really enjoyed that relationship I had with you at some point. And you can mention it. And you say, I don't know what is happening. I don't know what is taking up my mind or taking up my consciousness, taking up my time, but I would love to come back to that place. And at times, many times when people see that, they tend actually to draw back again and say, oh, maybe there's something wrong with me or there's something wrong I did to God. And that can be from the enemy trying to divert you. But child of God, if you're going through, if I'm speaking to someone and you're going through a season or a time in life where you feel like you used to be on fire for God, you used to desire things for Christ, but now you feel like you're in years whereby you're pulling yourself, like there's that stagnation, there's that place where you feel like you're so dry. Child of God, I want to bring good news to you. It is never too late. Anytime, any minute, wherever you are, the Holy Spirit can bring you back, can rejuvenate you, can regenerate you into that place where you can go back to the agape love. Because that fire, the relationship, the intimacy, the connection, the private conversations can come back to us when our consciousness is brought back to that place where we can rest in Christ. A lot of times what I've realized today, there are very many factors that can determine that as we're living in today, the world that we're living in today. There are very many factors that can play around with a helmet of salvation that you're carrying on your mind. There are very many things that can bring you to wandering, or they can distract you from the meditation time you've had with Jesus, from the meditation of the word, from giving you that alone time with Jesus. There are very many things. And so we must be very careful that the things that we involve ourselves into, the people, you know, we surround ourselves with, or anything. We must come to that place where, like I said, salvation is a gift that you will never experience anywhere. You start to guard it, to see it as something that you must carry with responsibility. Amen? Psalm 16:11 says that you will show me the path of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At your right hand are pleasures forever. So there are many times when we want to be in that place where we feel the pleasure forever, where we are connected with Christ in the fullness of joy, where his presence consumes us, where we feel like we're walking the path of life. And a lot of times, because of the busyness of life, because of the things we've given ourselves to that are not of him, there are many factors. There's so many factors today that can hinder you from having that concentration, that undivided concentration and focus, and have that deeper consciousness with Christ Jesus. But like I said, it is never too late, child of God. Christ, you come back to that place in prayer and you speak to the Holy Spirit. You know, this is where actually it becomes so deep, because as children of God under the Grace Covenant, our prayers shouldn't be about reciteful prayers where we come and you're talking to him. You're like, okay, you're the king of Al Shaddai, you're this, and you're speaking everything, you know, as, you know, much as all that is good. The times when we should be honest with him, we come and sit. I mean, like, Abba, I used to have this with you. I used to enjoy this moment with you, but I don't know what happened. I don't know where I got it wrong. I don't know where I put my time where maybe I shouldn't have put it. You be honest with him, just like you would talk to your best friend, just like you would talk to your parent, just like you would talk to any person you put your trust in. And that becomes so intimate. It becomes so deep. It becomes between you and him. And you're like, Papa, I want to seek you. But I feel like every time I do this, like I'm hitting the wall. What happened? What is it? Show me. Holy Spirit, guide me, lead me, teach me. And child of God, that prayer of honesty, that prayer where you're pouring out yourself to him, that prayer where you become vulnerable, that prayer where you come and say, Abba, I submit this to you and I need to know more and more of you. That place, child of God, where you're seeking Christ, where you've fallen on his feet and you're like, this is what I believe I want. He will meet you. He will transform the relationship both of you have been having, and you find yourself coming back to that strength. You find yourself, you're coming back to that meditation where your heart meditates on him at all times, where your words honor him, where you come and rest in him. I love what it is written in Psalm 27:8. It says that when you said, seek my face, my heart said to you, your face, Lord, I will seek. That was the words David said. And that is why, child of God, we come. And then the Holy Spirit will guide you step by step, leading you what to do, showing you what to do. And at the end of a certain time, child of God, you come to your place, you come to a place where you feel like you're regenerated again. And that means that your consciousness will be now directed and rooted and established again in Jesus Christ. But once you realize that you're not in that place anymore, then don't go far away from it. Come to him and ask him. Tell him, bring me back to that place. I want that. I desire that. I want it honestly. And that is what God wants us to do, to have that faith in him, to be honest with him. Amen? To have that relationship where both of the two, you know, it is a two-way relationship when you speak to him and both of you are father and child. Amen? Because he is our Abba. And see, going back to what Jesus Christ was showing us in John 5, we see that we can only go to God the Father through Jesus Christ. And so that means that the relationship that we have with Jesus Christ, it is so, so important. It is so important. Jeremiah 29:13, he says that, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. Meaning that God cannot go far, far away from you if you are actually seeking him. If you are actually wanting more of him, he can't run away from you. Amen? He can't. He can't never forsake you. He can never let go of you. As long as you keep searching him, seeking him, he will come more and more and more unto you. Psalm 145, 18 says that the Lord is near to all who call upon him and to all who call him in truth. Amen? I love what Jesus Christ said at the Sermon of the Mount when he said in Matthew 5, 8, blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. The pureness in our heart must come to that place where we pour out our all to him, whether good or bad. The times, actually, to be honest with you, the times when you will be the one who has wronged someone, the times when you will be the one who is in the wrong. But when you come and pour that place to him and say, listen, Abba, I might have done that to that person, but I know I am sorry, and forgive me, and let that person forgive me as well. And that place, both of you, where you are together, the Lord will see your heart. And you will see Jesus. You will see him. Because you are in that rightful place, your posture is to receive, and he will transform you. And the more he transforms you, the more your consciousness changes. The more your consciousness comes to be intertwined with his consciousness. So there's a difference between that life and the life of sin consciousness. Because the times when actually you find that even a believer is not of Christ consciousness, but they are more of the consciousness of sin. Either they are more of the consciousness of performance, the things they do for God, or they're more of the consciousness of what they should receive from God. You know, have you ever been around people who are all the time they're saying, I have a prayer request. I have this. I'm going to this pastor to go pray for me. I'm going to do this. I have to, you know, all the time it's about what they have to do for God or what God has to do for them. And there is no time or relationship where that place where they sit and say, at this moment, I don't want anything. The only thing is just to sit and love on him and be with him and feed on him and let him love me and let him pour his great love and his rich mercies and unveil himself to me. There's that time, child of God, where we must come, and the posture where we are is for us to receive that deep relationship with Jesus Christ. Amen. So in this place, you find that your awareness of your inner feelings, emotions, perceptions of the past, any wrongdoing, any behavior, any mindset of anything that is of legalism, that is of the law, that is of anything, it dies, it diminishes, it vanishes away. You know, for instance, I'm just going to give an example, right? The times when people will do something, right? Because, you know, we live in this world and the world is fallen, to be honest with you. The world is fallen. But you find that sometimes someone will do something and the guilt consciousness takes over. And that guilt consciousness will bring that reminders. It will remind this person all the time about their wrongdoing. And that will result into judgment. That person will judge themselves. They'll start to see themselves as inferior. They will acquire that inferiority complex. They will acquire shame. They will have all sorts of mixture things going on. Child of God, that sin consciousness or the guilt consciousness, part of it can also come from what we do actually do believe. Because if you're believing in a doctrine of the law that takes you back into showing you that if you don't do this, God is not going to do this. If you do this, God is not going to do this. That sort of language is going to bring you into that guilt consciousness every time you do something wrong. And every time, child of God, that place you acquire rational judgments based on worldly views or philosophies or beliefs or views, that can also actually instigate a consciousness that is so different from Christ's consciousness. Amen? And that will keep you in a cycle of thinking about yourself all the time anything you've done wrong. And that child of God is not how under the grace dispensation we live. It is not how we live, you know? So God, through his son, Jesus Christ, he sees each person, child of God, dear believer, beloved. He sees each person differently. He sees each person as God created him. He sees each person in his image. He sees each person as his own beloved son. So God sees us as the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. And although sometimes people who don't actually do believe in the grace covenant will say, so you mean like people are just going to sin around and not actually feel remorse about it and just say, God is going to forgive me? Listen, God is a God who loves. He hates sin, but he will love you no matter what you've done. But child of God, at the end of the day, certain things you do will also attribute to the consequences that you've done. For instance, let me give an example. As we live in this world, right? One can commit an offense or violate any sort of set of rules, right? And just because they did that, God cannot forsake them and say, I don't know them anymore, or I can't consider them as my child or my children. I can't do that. But he will not. He will not be definitely happy about what they've done, but he will forgive them because he is their creator. He is the one who loves them. However, on the other hand, because of what they've done, certain consequences that are set in place, let's say, for instance, the law in the world, right, that keeps the law and order, the court may decide that, listen, you killed someone, you may have to go to prison, you may have to do such and such years in prison. But that person, no matter what they've done, God can never forsake them. God can never disown them. Much as what the law can say, you're going to prison, God cannot say, as much as you've gone to prison, right, I am going to forsake you. You're not going to be my child anymore. God can't do that. He can't. Can I give you an example? You know, in the scriptures, we see in 1 Samuel, Saul was the king. And Saul, when he was given an instruction by God through the prophet, right? Prophet Samuel, to go and fight the Amalekites, right? What Paul did, he killed the Amalekites and left some. He didn't kill their leader. And then he also took some goods from that place, right? When you go back in 1 Samuel, you will read that story. But when he returned, he brought back those goods, and also he brought back the leader of the Amalekites. So God spoke to Samuel, Prophet Samuel, telling him that Saul had disobeyed him. He did not follow the instructions that he had given him. The scriptures show that Prophet Samuel wept. He could not believe that Saul had disobeyed what? God. And so God said that because of what he has done, I am going to strip off the kingship of him, like the title, and I'm going to choose my own. But at the end of the day, when you read the scriptures, right, you continue to see that Saul continued to serve, continued to be a leader, much as he had wronged God. God did not disown him and say, now you're gone out like that. Just like that. He did not. Amen. Until when David came in, as we all remember the story, Prophet Samuel had to go to the house of Jesse to look for the anointed one which God had chosen. And that was David. And when you go back into the scriptures, you come to your realization that God chose David not based on what the world would choose as a king, right? He chose someone who was actually looking after sheep. He chose someone who people never, ever expected. Amen? And so, actually, in 1 Samuel, it shows that God told Prophet Samuel that I don't look at his appearance, nor do I look at the physical stature, but I look at the heart. And God chose David's heart to be the king of Israel. So my point being that much as Saul, even you see in the Old Testament, you can truly see the heart of God. You can see the heart of God that it was for his people. He didn't want to disown any person. He did not. So much as God had even chosen David on that day, when David was anointed that very time, when Prophet Samuel anointed him with oil, can I say something that is very, very important? Saul was not taken out of the kingdom. He was never taken out of the palace. He was not. But God elevated David step by step, step by step, step by step, step by step. So Saul can be a very great example to show you that even when people wrong God, even when people do all sorts of things, they violate instruction of God, or they do anything, no matter what someone can do, no matter what it is, right? God will continue to be with that person. He will continue to love them. He will continue. But the consequences, at some point, they will reveal themselves. And as we all know the story, Saul later, he started being jealous, all that. But just because he walked in the flesh. And when we come and see this very story, this very example that I've given you, we remember that after you believe the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, what happens is that our consciousness is transformed from the consciousness of the old life. We are transferred into the consciousness of Jesus Christ. And then also our faith is guided for us to walk in the newness of life. And it's through that child of God that we take time to know the Lord Jesus Christ. We get to believe him. We get to know him. We get to believe in him. And we grow deeper in his consciousness. And it's through that consciousness, child of God, that all our guiltiness, the blameworthiness that we came with carrying, it dies. It dies. It goes away. Every shame goes away. Because those things that state, because the guiltiness, sin, the blameworthiness, all that is a state, right? A state of self-righteousness, a state of self-consciousness. You looking within and not looking to Jesus Christ. Because when you look at your shortcomings, child of God, they rob you from you having time with Jesus Christ. Self-consciousness can be that root of living in carnality and the flesh. This is something I must say. Because when you allow yourself to be out of the mind of Jesus Christ, out of the mind of the Great One, you find yourself that to a greater extent, you will think or respond to the self. You will respond to what the flesh wants you to do. You will respond in a carnal way. A lot of times, self-righteousness causes believers to compare themselves amongst each other. And a very great example, I can take you back again to King Saul and David. He became very jealous of him. He became very jealous of him at some point. So comparing amongst other believers, other people, is a very, very big sign that you're walking in self-consciousness, you're walking in self-righteousness, you're walking away from Christ. Because the Spirit of the Lord can never carry that sort of spirit. Amen? In an environment where one is content, fulfilled and satisfied, they will always be looking. They will always be looking to Jesus Christ. But on the other hand, if the environment, people are not contented, they're not fulfilled, they're not satisfied, there's a very big, large extent that many people will want validation. Many people will want acceptance. They will want compliments. They will want acknowledgments. They will want importance in order for them to feel like they're fulfilled. That sense of longing to be connected to those people who matter, or to have a certain class of status so that you can feel so great of, let's say, for instance, of yourself, or have that self-consciousness that is fulfilled. Child of God, those are all signs to show you that your consciousness is not actually where it should be as a believer. Seeking to be appraised or valued or recognized, all that, child of God, dear believer, they rob you from knowing and believing truly what God created you to be. They will, because now your mind is set on other people. Your mind is comparing. Your consciousness is about what other people are doing, what other people think of you, what other people are speaking of you. Another great example is that we must actually come to that place where we see ourselves as Christ sees us. Because when we see ourselves as Christ sees us, that part of us looking within ourselves dies. Amen. Today we can borrow from examples that I've given you of Saul and David and come to that place of seeing that self-righteousness and awareness can be a very great hindrance to your rest in Jesus Christ's grace each day. It can. Because when you're comparing yourselves to amongst other believers, child of God, that creates or it clouds you from actually receiving his rich masses that are so new to you every morning. It clouds you from coming to that place of receiving the great love daily, being transformed in him daily, coming into that deeper relationship that I talked about. Amen. Because here's the thing, child of God, seeing ourselves or being aware of Jesus Christ will enable us to see him as the only one who matters in our lives. Amen. Actually, today, it can also be something else that can lead us into that place as well. For instance, today we are in the era of technology, right? Today we're living in times where everything is so digital. So if one is not aware of the extreme usage of social media, one can find themselves that they've been negatively impacted in their lives to be conformed into other people's lives or their self-consciousness. Amen. And we must be very careful why we use certain things. Always ask yourself, why do I do what I do? Why am I using this tool for what I use it for? Because some of those questions are going to enable you to evaluate sometimes your life, your choices, your decisions. They will help you. Because when one uses social media in order to acquire likes or to acquire fame, to acquire, right now I understand this, that word called influencers, right? But child of God, the question must be is that how am I influencing other people? Are you influencing people positively? Are you influencing people by proclaiming the gospel of Christ? You see, some of these things, and don't get me wrong, social media is a powerful and a very needed tool today, a digital tool needed today, because when we use it, we can easily access anything at just a click. Hallelujah. On a positive side, it can be that convenient way actually we can preach the gospel. Many of you right now are listening through you're listening to the sermons via the internet radio, via Facebook, via all means that we have created by the grace of God to take out the gospel. And so that is a powerful purpose and way to use the gospel to reach many and many, many communities. Amen. So it is a tool we must thank the Lord for. It is a tool we must not take for granted. And we must thank actually God that he has given the wisdom and knowledge to companies that are using this as a way of enabling people to acquire information that is transforming and changing their lives for the better. And because when you sit down and think about this, social media is that tool that has positively also greatly and impacted lives of people around the world. And most especially, for instance, we saw the advantages, the pros of this tool in the lockdown. Many people were not going to church, or everything was just digital. It was on social media. However much this is also so good based on what we're using it today, we're using it for, and all the purposes we're using it for, the enemy can also use it for wrong things. And if one is not careful, the enemy can divert them divert their focus, divert their concentration, and use it for wrong purposes. Amen? So social media can be that tool that can rob one of their concentration, of their focus in this life. It can consume your time for leisure purposes. Amen? It is time consuming, and also can one can base in the information that they gather on a daily basis can also hinder people from looking onto Jesus. Because, for instance, let me give this example, right? When you spend 30 minutes, an hour, 2 hours, for instance, you're looking at people's news feeds, right? You're responding to messages with that and that. And life is like that, right? Every single hour, you're like that. That means that is the world you're living in. No, whether you like it or not, that's the fact. That is the world you've created. And so that world can keep you so busy that by the end of the day, you go back to your bed and you're going to, you know, turn in and sleep. You find yourself very tired. But at the end of the day, you've really actually not accomplished anything during the whole day. But you have been in that state where your consciousness is based on the leisureness. And I think, okay, it's not bad to have time off and be of leisure, but if most of your time you use it for that, then child of God, that means that a lot of things in your life are put on hold. A lot of things in your life are stagnant because you give something much more of your time as opposed to having time management towards certain things. Amen? So, don't take me wrong. Not all people who, let's say, for instance, are sharing or gathering information on social media are creating self-awareness. No, but one has to ask themselves, what is my motive? Why am I actually putting my life out there? Why am I actually doing this? Am I doing this? You have to ask yourself those questions, because once you ask yourself those questions, you will learn to evaluate your life. You will learn to see where you should stop, either to use this tool in a negative way or in a way that is not being so productive. You come to a realization, you ask yourself, if I'm using social media, am I using it for self-awareness? Am I using it for self-validation? Am I self-absorbed in this? Those questions really do matter for you as a believer, because if you're posting something and all the time you're looking at your phone to see whether you have more likes or whether you have this, you have that. So that means that your consciousness, your inner self, your perception, your view, your mindset is all locked up onto that. And child of God, God created us for bigger things. God created you and I and every believer, every born again person listening in today, and those who are around the world, brothers and sisters, brethren, to do bigger things as opposed to just sitting, right? And our life is only based on that. Child of God, did you know that you are co-heir with Jesus Christ? Our minds and everything in us should be dead to ourselves, but born to the Spirit of the Lord. Amen? Remember, the scripture reminds us that those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Amen? So we are co-heirs with Jesus. Start to see yourself that way. Remember, I asked that question before we started the service. What happens after we are born again? Many times people ask themselves that question. But when you come to that place of understanding that your consciousness is very, very vital and it is something you must guard with so much reverence, then, child of God, some of these factors that take you away from the concentration and focus on the Lord Jesus Christ, they vanish. They are diminished. They become nothing. You start to see yourself as a co-heir with Jesus Christ. You start to take up your place, your responsibility, your assignments that God has given you in this life. And you don't take life for granted, because now you start to know that I used to be this in the old life, but now I'm walking in life because Christ has given me life. For instance, actually, you come to that place where you know that anything now I do, I'm led of the Spirit, because I am of the Spirit and the things that I do are of the Spirit. Romans 8, 16, 17 says that the Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, and heirs of God, and a joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, then we may also be glorified together. So child of God, anything that Christ was, you became it. You became it at the cross. Amen? You became it. You walk in the fullness of Jesus. You walk in his grace. You walk in him. So right now, we don't consider ourselves, or we don't see ourselves any other thing as opposed to what Christ sees us. Or as opposed to what the world tells you you should see yourself. Like I was giving that example of influencers around the world. Ask yourself, okay, if I'm following this person, how are they really adding to my life? How are they adding to my eternal life? How are they contributing to how I think of Christ? That should be your question. Because now you are a co-heir in Jesus Christ, right? So anything that pertains to your life should be in the foundation of Jesus, established in Jesus, rooted in Jesus, because now you're not of the world anymore. So ask yourself, when I'm following this person, right, on social media, when I'm looking at their posts, when I'm following their whatever that I'm following, how is this of help to me? What is it adding to my life? Is it adding any cubit? Is it adding any centimeter? Is it adding anything? Ask yourselves those questions. Because when you evaluate yourself with such questions, child of God, many things are going to be transformed in your life. Because your consciousness is going to be leading you to things that are of the Spirit, things that are of Christ, things that are made of him, as opposed to things that rob you of what actually really matters. Amen? So child of God, you're free. You're free from that indwelling self-consciousness, free from that indwelling self-awareness. You're free from that indwelling validation, wanting compliments, free from that. You're free. You're free. Be secure, be fulfilled, be firm, be bold in Jesus Christ, knowing that Christ is enough for you. You are free, child of God, from what held your mind for you to walk in that place where you feel like you're inferior. You need people to give you that status. You're free. Be free. Be free from people. Be free from the world. Be free. Look to Jesus. Look to God. Continue to desire the things that are of him. Come to that place where you say, I want more and more and more. You know, honestly, pray an honest prayer to him. And child of God, your life will be changed. Amen? So what you need is to hear more of Jesus Christ. What you need is your faith to be burgeoned into walking with the everlasting grace of our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans 8:1 says that there is therefore now condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit, child of God. There is no more condemnation. There is no more guiltiness. There is no more you looking for awareness from people, from you looking for validation. There is no more you. That was in the old. Child of God, let that be in the old. The old patterns should not linger around and rob you from that concentration with Jesus. Our consciousness should be in Christ. The Bible Father says in Romans 8:2 that for the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do in that it was weak through the flesh, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh on account of sin. He condemned sin in the flesh. So child of God, anything that was in your old life was placed on the body of Jesus Christ. And that is why on this program, I always say, for the cross is the answer. At the cross, many things were transformed in your life, in my life, in every dear believer's life. At the cross, Christ took your all and you took his. You became him. So what happened after you became born again is that you carry the fullness of Christ in you. You carry his likeness. You carry his righteousness in your body, in your mind, in your mouth, in your eyes, in your ears, in your hands, in every single aspect of your life. Amen? The scripture further says in Romans 8, for that the righteous requirement of the law may be fulfilled in us who do not walk according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. It's only through Christ Jesus Christ that we walk in a fulfillment of the Spirit, child of God. Amen? For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Child of God, as we end today's service, I want you to know something. When you became born again, you were transformed. You were ushered. You were taken from the old man and taken into the new creation in Christ Jesus. Right now, you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. So for you to live according to the flesh, set on the things of the flesh, that is you going back to the old man. That is you going back to the life actually that you are redeemed from. Amen. Romans 5:1, I know Apostle Paul reminded that believers in Galatians, telling them, why are you bewitched? Like, why would you let yourself go back to the bondages that you were removed from? Amen. And like, for instance, social media, you may look at it as, let's say, for instance, a tool that is not negatively impacting your life in some way because you think it is social media. Amen. But you have to actually remember that the era that we're in, this may not have been the issue 20 years back or 10 years back. 10 years back, 20 years back, it was something else. And 10 years from now, it can be something else. 20 years from now, it can be something else. 30 years from now, it can be something else. Again, that is going to bring that divided attention and that people may not have that concentration on Christ. But Christ has given us the Spirit within us. That to discern and to see why we should be doing what we do. Amen? Ask yourselves, right? If this thing is for Christ, if Christ is in this, then I am in this. If this does not have Christ in it, then that is not me. Because we have to also draw a line under the sand. We have to separate some things. For the Bible says, going back to Romans 8:6, for to be carnally minded is death, but to the spiritually minded is life and in peace. If something is not giving you peace, it is not bringing life to you, then why are you following it? Why are you looking at it as something that you're receiving information from? So some of these things, it is us to make the decisions. It is us to make some changes through the Holy Spirit. You pray about it. You're like, listen, I need change. You say, you know what? I don't know whether I can change this, but I know you are my helper and my comforter, and you can do this for me. And child of God, you see some things go. You see some things change, and the only thing that will remain is the consciousness in Jesus Christ. Father, in the name of Jesus, we thank you so much for your word that you have given us. We thank you for every blessing and every single word we've partaken and received today. We receive your consciousness. Anything that has been in our minds, anything in our surroundings, anything in our lives that has been consuming us, taking up our time, robbing us from having time with you, connection with you, relationship with you, intimacy with you. We pray that right now, Lord, that you take that away. Give us you. Let me see only you, Jesus. Let us see only you, Jesus. Let me hear only you, Jesus. Let us only hear you, Jesus. Let me know more and more and more of you. Let me desire you. Let me want more, Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, show me more. Lead me. Direct me step by step. Bring me to that place where I desire to hear more and more of you, Lord. Where I desire to read more and more of your word. Holy Spirit, guide me. Take away any constant thought patterns, any old patterns, anything that is not of Jesus. You consume it. You pluck it out of me, you cast it into abyss, and it will never have any time or priority or any place in my heart, in my mind, my soul, my spirit. And from today, I receive Christ consciousness in Jesus' name. I pray and say amen. So child of God, I want to take a moment to also pray for those who say, I want to know the Lord Jesus Christ. I've listened to this sermon and I want to receive him as my Lord and Savior. I want this great gift of salvation you've taught about, you've preached about. And I would also want the Lord to give me his consciousness. And if you're someone who says, you know what, evangelist, I'm born again, but I kind of slipped away. I became too common with the things that of the world and a kind of lost touch. I need really to come back to that place, the agape love. So if you're two those people, I pray this moment to say these words with me. Say, Heavenly Father, through your Son, Christ Jesus, today I believe and confess with my mouth that I'm saved by the grace of God, not through my works or effort. I am forever justified by faith through your Son. Jesus, you are delivered for all my past, present, and future sins, and you were raised for my justification. From today, I renounce my old man and nature because it was crucified with you at the cross. I now live and walk in the newness of life in Christ Jesus. I am born of Christ. I believe I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Child of God, I want to welcome you to the greatest gift of salvation. Salvation is supernatural. It is divine. It is an honor to walk with the Son of God daily through his Holy Spirit. It is wonderful. It is a great gift anyone can ever receive through grace. And I pray that you, because you must know yourself that you're a new creation. You've gone away now from what you are. You were all before you came on this program, or before you listened, or before you came to know to confess the Lord Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You're new. So meaning that child of God, now that you're new, everything is going to be new for you. So listen to this sermon actually again, because what I taught about today will help you a lot. The question that I was preaching about, what happens next? What happens next when we become born again? What happens next? Listen and listen and listen, and you understand, because once you understand that it's the Christ consciousness that you need to walk in this journey of salvation, your life will never be the same again. Amen. So please find a church in your communities, because the reason why I say this, child of God, can everyone listen? The reason why I say you should find a church is because the gospel of grace, amen, was never created or given to us as one you only receive as an individual and you stay in your home and that's it. No. The gospel of grace, you see, the church was born through Christ on that cross. It is very, very important for you to be located also in a church where they teach the gospel of Jesus Christ, for you to be involved in the things of Christ. And this is what I mean by actually you acquiring that consciousness of Jesus Christ. When you are involved with other believers, you're next to other believers too, you work with them, you're doing things of Christ in a community form, child of God, you're going to grow more. You're going to grow in Christ. But don't stay in your own zone and you think you're going to grow. No. The church was born of Christ. Amen. It was the bride of Christ. So you also have to find that church. But like I say, find a church in your country, in your community that preaches the true gospel of Jesus. Because the more of Jesus Christ you will know, the more you will grow. The more you find truth, the more you'll be filled with his grace, the more you acquire knowledge in Jesus Christ, and the more you will enjoy this gift of salvation. Amen. So may God continuously bless and each and every one of you. I want to speak a blessing upon every one of you. I pray that the Lord covers you and protects you, all of you, everywhere you are, in your countries, in your communities, in your societies. I pray for a hedge of protection, each and every one of you and your families, your children, your husbands, your wives, protection from COVID-19, and then also any other thing. And then also I want to pray a blessing of Abraham upon each and every person listening in. Everything you touch, let it see a blessing from God. Amen. I pray for each and every dear partner in this ministry. I continuously pray for them. May God bless you and may God keep you. Talk to you next week. Bye.